Hey guys, the mic works well, right? Good. So glad to see you here. The end of the day. I'm a bit of jet-lagged from Israel. My name is Val, and I'm going to present today a tutorial session about eBPF and how can we use different open source tools in order to deal with day-to-day problems and perform some interesting actions. A little bit about me. I'm the CTO and co-founder of Secret. And, in my past, I was a vulnerability researcher and kernel enthusiast. Have some hobbies of snowboarding, chess player, and football. I know it's not a big, it's not a common mix. Also founded at Secret eBPF IL community. After that, you can, in the slides, see a link to a Slack workspace of the community, and you can join. It's a small one, but very cozy, and there are interesting topics going over there. Just a short word about Secret. We are building API management platform. We are combining real-time data and by analyzing traffic with API specifications. We are utilizing heavily eBPF technology. Our agent is built on top of eBPF. Soon going to be open sourced, still not open sourced, but it's going on the way. Just a short disclaimer about this presentation. As you will see, I built it entirely from existing sources on the internet, different blogs, different tutorials, and existing open source tools. In the end of the presentation, you will find a references slide with all the relevant links grouped by categories, and then you can follow it and take a deeper look into a particular topic if something catches your eye. I will leave some time for questions in the end as well. And I understood that there is also a virtual audience, and there will be some virtual audience questions. A little bit about the agenda. So we will talk, we'll do some small introduction to eBPF. We're not going to deep dive too much into theoretics, but we'll do cover up some basic stuff. Then we will talk about DSL. DSL stands for Domain Specific Language for eBPF, and there we will, I'll show you a couple of live demos of using BPF Trace tool and BCC toolkit, different tools that some of you or maybe all of you are familiar with, and we will discuss different scenarios. After that, we'll take some specific use case of capturing HTTPS traffic. Something that we are dealing with it also at Secret, where we need to catch traffic from APIs communication, and sometimes it's encrypted. And we will see how using eBPF it can be done. We will dive a little bit into the some details, but again, not too much, so don't worry. We will talk about some management of eBPF programs. And at the end, the last topic, we will talk about Cori, which is an emerging way of writing eBPF programs. Cori stands for Compile Once, Run Everywhere. We'll cover it at the end. That's it. So a bit history about eBPF. eBPF stands for Extended Barclay Packet Filtering. BPF, Packet Barclay Filter, was invented long, long time ago. Also known as CBPF, like classic BPF. I think most of us, at least I myself, were familiar with it through a TCP dump tool, where you can just create different filters and filter out some traffic based on some specific language. And some disclaimer, like at the beginning when we started Secret, we were using actually a wrapper of TCP dump in Kubernetes environment in order to catch the traffic running as a sidecar, but then eventually we switched to the eBPF-based agent, and it gained us a lot of different profits that we will discuss also. Basically, eBPF allows you to execute small programs inside the operating system kernel, differently from like regular kernel development, like driver development, it secures the execution by running it in a designated sandbox. So you as a developer don't need to worry that you will make a mistake or screw up the operating system. Your program is verified prior to execution, and there are some limitations. We will touch them also during this topic, during this call. And after the successful verification, your program is running inside the kernel. You're getting access to a lot of different kernel APIs, which is very cool and was not possible before this technology. And of course, as you can imagine, it allows a big gain in performance because you can execute some codes inside the kernel. You don't need to go back to the user space and et cetera. So some basic diagram taking from the main website of eBPF, eBPF.io. There are different use cases that this technology can be used for. Let's talk about some very basic ones. There is networking things that can be done using eBPF and gain some performance and improve different use cases. Recently, Cloudflare posted a very interesting blog post about how they improved socket binding using eBPF instead of relying on the traditional way. There are security use cases where eBPF programs can be attached to LSM hooks and can extend the functionality inside the Linux kernel in order to perform different security operations on different data, such as traffic or other events that are happening inside operating system. There's an observability and tracing use case. This is one that we are doing it at Secret, basically utilizing eBPF in order to capture traffic and analyze it, parse application level protocols such as HTTP, HTTPS, HTTP2, getting some insights from live traffic and propagating it all the way to our SaaS platform. There are also some tools that are built on top of eBPF that are doing profiling. And I think there are multiple different profilers, open source nowadays, that can profile and perform different tracing of your application based regardless on the programming language that you are using. And at the end, we will touch like a very famous open source projects. I'm not going to show the demos of like the biggest projects such as Cilium and Catron and etc. But just for you to know, there are some of like very famous and big broad projects with a lot of GitHub stars that already built natively on top of eBPF. There are different SDKs that are being more and more extended in order to provide the way and the easy entrance to different developers into the eBPF world. Like it started with C language, but nowadays there are different wrappers that allow you to develop your applications in Rust, there are also wrappers in Go and Python and some other languages as well. So let's talk about eBPF program lifecycle very quickly. It starts with a source code that we are writing in C language. As I mentioned, it's also possible to write it today in Rust. There is some open source project called RedBPF, which basically translates Rust instructions into eBPF bytecode. After that, the source code is being compiled using Clang and LLVM, and it's being translated into eBPF bytecode. And then, at this point, this bytecode is being loaded into kernel, and it undergoes some crucial stages before it can actually be executed inside the kernel operating system. So at the beginning, there is a verifier. Pretty complex portion, not very well documented. Even so, there is some presentation, forgot who did that, but talks about the internals of the verifier a little bit. But basically, the purpose of the verifier is to make sure that we as the developers don't write something by mistake or maliciously that can perform some unwanted operations inside the kernel, inside the operating system kernel. For example, we don't want to be able to modify some kernel memory directly. That's just one. Or, for example, we don't want to have endless loops inside our eBPF program because it can stop and it can cause deadlocks and crashes of Linux kernel. After the successful verification, there is a JIT compiler. Basically, there is a sandbox VM that is running our eBPF code inside the Linux kernel, and the JIT compiler is in charge of translating the eBPF bytecode into the code that is going to run. The eBPF VM utilizing very similar to a standard processor execution, utilizing registers and different opcodes in order to execute the programs on the kernel level. Once the code is running, there is, most of the times, not always, but most of the times, we want to communicate with it somehow from a user space program. And this is done via specific communication options that are available for us in the via eBPF. The major one is maps. So basically, maps are shared objects that user space and kernel space can communicate with each other to exchange data. It's also being used by different eBPF programs inside the kernel. Basically, different programs can communicate with each other through shared maps. And the entire mechanism is event-driven, so in order for your eBPF program to be executed, there are some events that has to happen in kernel. For example, traffic arrives to a socket, like socket receive message. Or for example, there was a syscall call for a new process, or et cetera, et cetera. Once the event is being triggered, there is the eBPF program that was attached to this particular event is being executed, and then the user space can get information through the maps that I explained earlier. Okay. I think every time I saw some eBPF presentation or video, there is always a slide that this picture. Literally, I don't think I haven't seen one presentation without this slide, so I said I won't be an exception for that. So BCC framework is a BPF compiler collection. Before BCC, in order to write a BPF program, you have to write it in the intermediate language. You have to write like kind of assembly opcodes. But BCC framework allowed to write C code, which was translated into eBPF bytecode. But apart from the compiler, it comes with a lot of different tools that were written by the community and still are being extended. I think even this picture is outdated already, and there are much more tools in different areas as described here. Today, during the presentation, I'm going to run some of the tools and show like what we can get from it. For example, there are some tools like for traffic sniffing. There are some tools for file system reads. There are some tools for TCP/UDP protocol and different statistics about connection, about sockets, and et cetera, et cetera. We will start with a BPF trace. As I said before, the easiest way into a BPF world is using, I think it's a shared opinion over the internet, is using BPF trace. Basically, it's a DSL, domain-specific language, that allows you to create very fast some actually working applications that can perform different tasks without the need to write any C code or any other programming language. The language of BPF trace is well documented in the public repo. We will go over some basic syntax, and then I will show you some of the existing tools. There's a diagram of the internals, how it's working behind the scenes. Not going to dive too much inside, but we will focus on this part, on the program itself. There is a very good presentation of Brendan Gregg that explains each one of the parts with deep dive into code and how it works. But basically, domain-specific language is being translated using parser into AST, and then some semantic analyzers, and then code generation, and then eventually we get a BPF bytecode. So some basic stuff about BPF trace syntax. BPF trace is a binary tool that accepts basically three major parameters. There is a probe. The probe is actually the event, the kernel event, as I mentioned before. It's event-driven mechanism, so it's some event that should happen that will trigger some action. The first parameter you mentioned, which probe do you want to attach? Then there is optional parameter, which is a filter. So you can filter out some of the events, and you can execute your action on specific events. For example, if you want to trace only a specific process, you don't want to trace all of the processes. So you can put a filter saying like only for process ID that equals to XYZ, or process name that equals to ABC. And then there is an action. An action actually can be concatenated list of different actions that you can execute based on when the probe is triggered. There are different types of probes, and I think now in this slide it's a good time to explain a little bit about each one of them. First, we'll start with a trace point. The trace point is some predefined entry inside the kernel, so like the kernel was compiled with the trace points inside. And it allows you to execute some handler when it reaches the trace point. Very common trace points is upon entry of the function, upon exit of the function inside the kernel. There are other types of probes, which called K-probes or K-RET probes. Those are more dynamic. It allows you to insert basically your handler in any kernel function as long as you have a symbol for it. And kprop-go stands for the beginning of the function, and kret-prop stands for the end of the function. Ret is return. Uprob, we will touch actually during the example of HTTPS, but it's similar to kprob, like, but it's not in the kernel level, but in the user level. eBPF allows you to put your actions, to put your hooks also in the user mode, in some other processes, and we will find it very useful when we will discuss how we can capture HTTPS traffic and show it in plain mode and not encrypted. Then there are variables that allow you, there are specific, as I said, in DSL, that allow you to declare different variables, global, local variables, variables with arrays. We will see, we'll open one of the programs of PPF trace tools, and we'll go over the code and discuss it. There are some built-in functions that are, or built-in reserve words that are very useful. For example, COM stands for a process name. So basically, you just can use inside your BPF trace program a COM, and then it will return a process name. Count is a built-in function that counts different events. There is a hist and lhist, which allows you to build histograms based on events that are happening. Retval, as everyone knows, it's a return value, and there are much more. There's a lot of functions. I think I have it opened here, just a second. Basically, there is a reference guide which explains each one of the functions and shows how to use them with small examples. It's inside the BPF trace repo. So I think now, after some basic explanation of BPF trace, we will switch to a demo, and I will show you some basic stuff that we can do with BPF trace. So let me this just a second. So I don't know if can you see it? Okay. So I'm inside the. I've cloned the repo of BPF trace, and I'm inside the folder called tools. Basically, I don't see what I'm showing, but I'll try to. So for example, what we can show here, like the common extension for BPF trace commands is .bt, and we will use something like, for example. Just a second. Okay. Okay, so we'll execute command that does syscount. Basically, it counts the number of syscalls called by each process. So I just ran a BPF trace command. It attached the probe, as you can see, and now it's counting. Once I stopped, we can see output, and we can see like each process, how many syscalls does it call. Now let's open this program, and let's take a look how it looks like. Second, I think I'll just switch to duplicate because I can't see anything. Okay. So, yeah. Can you still see it, or is it too small? So SysCount is, as I said, one of the tools that are provided part of the BPF Trace repo, and it starts, so there's an option to execute some commands at the beginning of BPF Trace program. Usually they are under the begin block. So here we're just printing some information that it started, and you need to hit Control-C to stop. Then this is actually the actual probe that is going to be executed. So as I mentioned before, we have different types of probes. In this case, we are using TracePoint, and we are attaching it for sysenter. So every time basically there is a syscall called, our probe is going to be, the probe is going to be fired, and then our action is going to be executed. And what we are doing in the action, we have a global variable called syscall, which is an array. We are using an ID of the process. We are using the syscall number, and then we are doing count. So basically, if I switch here, you can see that for each syscall, we have a number of times it was executed. In this program, we didn't do the translation from a syscall number to a textual representation. It's possible to do. But here we are counting the syscalls, and we are storing it into the array. The second array, which is also a global array called process, the key is the process name. As I mentioned before, com is a built-in that provides us a process name inside the BPF program. And we're also using a count in order to count how many syscalls were executed. And you can see here, the com returns a string representation of the process name. And then at the end, we are just printing the values that we received. So as you can see, very simple program written in a special language, not C language. When we will discuss a BPF tool, we will see what's happening behind the scenes. But you can imagine, like we discussed previously, that the main communication way between user mode and the kernel mode is through maps. So basically, this program is being translated into some maps that are being used by the user space and the kernel space, and then those maps are being populated by a kernel program, and the user space is then just reading from the maps. Everything is encapsulated for us because of the brilliance of BPF Trace tool. Okay. So now let's do something, just a second, I'll switch back if you don't mind, sorry about that. Okay, one more thing that I wanted to show is actually, instead of running existing programs, there are also an option to run specific actions that writing them as part of the code and not in the file. So going back to the terminal. So here I'm going to execute a BPF trace program. Minus E stands for that we are actually writing a string for an action that is going to be executed. And the string is here, we are attaching again for a trace point. This time the trace point is in the syscall called open at. So basically when some file is being opened. And then what we are doing, we are printing the process name and we are trying to print the name of the file, so that one of the args. So, okay, there's a lot of files being opened on my computer. But as you saw, it's a very simple one-liners that I can just execute. Again, if you go to a BPF trace repo, you will find a very nice list that of those one-liners that you can run and achieve different results. What I want to show here, it's very, very simple. And there is a huge bridge being the huge gap that being bridged for you by BPF trace that you don't need to write from scratch C program or even before like some assembly program, and you can just run a high level language in order to achieve this information from utilizing Linux kernel capabilities. One more thing, a funny demo that I stumbled across. Again, I will show you. And just a second. Yeah, sorry for switching the displays I have here. Okay, so I found it also online and it really amused me. Some guy wrote a program that basically, a BPF program that basically allows him to lock in and lock out his computer based on the Bluetooth signal from his phone. It's really cool. So I tried to run it and there had some problems there. So I've tried to fix it a little bit. So we'll try to run it together here. But in order to explain you like what actually happens, so let me, okay, I'm going to show you like, so at the beginning, what we are trying to do, this, I'm still not running any BPF program, but I'm trying to explain you like what the way that you need to, like I needed to go in order to understand it. So basically, I wanted to understand, I needed to understand what are the kernel methods of Bluetooth, you know, that I want to put a hook on it. So basically, I'm using a trace CMD in order to record the session. And then, right. Okay, I'm giving a report. There's a lot of stuff, but here we can find the stack traces. The interesting function for us is management device found, which has been triggered when there is a signal from the device to the laptop. And the interesting part of it is that I showed you that we can access the parameters of the kernel of the kernel function, not just the syscall itself. And I mean, I'm not going to show you the source code of Linux, but basically the parameters allow you to see the MAC address of the device and also the signal strength. So just in order to show you this, let's try to run. Again, we're using BPF trace, right? To write from here. Okay, there's a lot of devices that are communicating, and you can see it here, and there's a, the second column is the signal strength. So this is one. The second one, function called management device disconnected. This is an event being triggered when a device that is already connected to my laptop is being disconnected from my laptop. I will try to show you. Okay, so now I'm connected. I am going to disconnect. And here, like you can see, that was printed. This is my MAC address of the of my phone. So basically, what we can do, we can create some very simple script that just using some log file, we can try to detect when the device is in the range of the computer and then unlock the computer, like without needing to type the password, and then the device goes a little bit away, the signal strength is going to be lower, we can lock it. So that's what we did here. I commented out the unlock session, because I don't want to mess with the screen. But we're just going to print locked and unlocked, and let's hope that it will work. We'll try to do a live demo now. So the only parameter that our script gets is the MAC address of my phone. And I'm going to ask Amit to take my phone a little bit away, and let's hope that it will catch it. No. Okay. No. Can you try to disconnect from the Bluetooth? Okay, it captured the disconnected device. Okay, can you connect and come closer? Let's see if we are getting an unlocked. Okay, we got unlocked because now the phone now in the proximity. Yeah, for some reason, the locked event didn't, were not captured. My point is that it was very, very simple to do this stuff, and instead of writing some extensions for Bluetooth driver or whatever, I just examined, understood what are the functions that are being called. Or Linux is open source. I saw the code, I saw the parameters that are being passed, so I can see the values, and then those are the actual programs, like two, three lines. We are basically parsing a MAC address, which is an array, and then here we are doing a MAC address and the signal strength, and that's it. Okay. Okay, now we'll talk a little bit about HTTPS traffic, and here we will touch a different zone of eBPF programs, which is in the user space. So until now, we saw attaching to trace points, a similar way we can attach to K-probes. But this is code that is running inside the kernel. Let's discuss a HTTPS traffic use case. So basically, there is application, and in the normal, in the without the TLS, the application just using syscalls of the socket in order to connect, receive, send messages. When TLS is involved and we want to encrypt the application, we are actually going through another layer, which is a TLS library. There are different popular libraries that provide TLS implementation. OpenSSL is one of them. There are also other options. And basically, their purpose is to encrypt the buffers before they're sent to the Linux kernel. What's the time? Okay. So if we are running, if we put a kprobe on receive or send message, we will receive already encrypted buffer, or basically we won't be able to present a plain text. So in this case, kprobes is not a good option, but instead we can use uprobes. The mechanism is pretty similar. It's adding a hook inside some of the function, but in this case, the function resides in the user mode, is some in some shared library. So what we need to find the place inside the shared library where we want to put a hook. As you can see from this diagram, SSL write and SSL read are two very good candidates for the OpenSSL library. And those both functions are exported symbols, so it's very easy to find. And when we attach the hooks there, we can actually see the data just before it's being encrypted or just after it was decrypted. So for this demonstration, what I wanted to show is I sent just a CURL. CURL is using this library. I sent I just sent CURL to https github.com, and well, CURL does present the information because it's a client, so it after the decryption. But the Wireshark, as you saw there, it shows only encrypted information. What I will show you here, we will use a tool called SSL Sniff. We are running, in this case, it's not a BPF trace program. It's one of the tools that are coming with the BCC framework with a Python frontend. So Python frontend, by that I mean a user mode application that controls the eBPF program. And we are going to going to send a message to GitHub, and it should be here. I think we are getting the result of the response, which is in a plain text. As you can see here, the message is chunked into different chunks because that's how we receive it inside the socket, and we receive those buffers sequentially to the user space. But with some additional very basic logic, we can combine it into one buffer, and then we can have this message as a plain data. We are utilizing a very similar technique. We are not using the SSL sniff utility, but instead we have it in our platform, but we do it also in secret in order to capture TLS encrypted traffic. The issue with uprobs that there need to be specific for a user space shared library. Like, so if you are in kernel, then there is only one place where you can put a hook, like receive message or send message of a socket. For user space libraries, there are different libraries, different implementations. And for some programming languages, it becomes very interesting and challenging, especially for those that have its own VM, like Java, because there is no exported symbol. The code is a Java library which is being compiled in runtime, and it's much more difficult to attach, to find a hook and attach to it. eCapture is another open source tool that allows you to perform similar things. I think we're a little bit short of time, so I won't present it to you, but it allows to capture HTTPS traffic, and they have, they support today, I think, three or four major OpenSSL libraries, OpenSSL and a few more, I think GNU SSL and a few others. So like if an application is using different library, eCapture also can capture that. So yeah, we went through a demo. BPF tool, that's a next thing that we are going to talk about. Actually, this one is not to execute specific commands. It allows to load the BPF programs into kernel, but it allows to do much more. It allows you to manage your BPF programs, and it provides some inspection and some profiling and some useful information for you as the eBPF developer that you can gain about different eBPF applications that are running, that whether you develop them or they're already running on your machine. Let's start with something very, very simple. So, I think we can start with this. We'll run this again. And okay, this is a command prog list or prog show. It shows you all eBPF programs that are loaded currently on the machine. There's a lot of programs that exists, but what is interesting for us, I can do it like this. I'm going to. Yeah. Here we can see at the end there are three programs called the kprobe, which is the weird, should be a probe, but on the function probe SSL, read, write, enter, write, exit, and read, exit. Let's do something else. Let's run our previously trace point that we did, and then let's do it again. Okay, and we'll see here trace point that was attached. In the recent versions of VPF program, we can also get some statistics of how many times it was hit and how many times in nanoseconds it was it used. Then what we can also see, we can dump the bytecode of the program, provided the ID. Then we can see the actual code of our eBPF program. Again, it's not something that's interesting for us every time, but sometimes when we need to troubleshoot, we can see like what how the program looks like. We can pin a program, so like here, every time I hit, I stop the user mode, and then if I show you now, you will see that this program doesn't exist anymore. And when we are pinning a program, even when we detach it from user mode, it will still the eBPF program will still continue to be executed inside the kernel. We have some interesting things that let's run it again. Actually, let's run. Okay, let's run the syscall and then let's do instead of program, we can also show different maps that are being used. As I said before, maps are the mechanism in order to communicate between user space and kernel space. And here we can see different maps that are used by our program. I think one of the parameters is the actual program that is using the map. We can also show the content of the map, given the ID. Like, let's take here. We have this map. Remember when we explored the syscount BPF trace program? I'll show you it again. We have just two lines here. And we discussed that those are being translated into maps behind the scenes. So we can see here that those are the maps that are being created. And we can actually dump the values of the map in order to see. Let's PF2 map. OK. And we can see like in live the values of the map. It can help us to troubleshoot programs, especially if the programs are a little bit more complex, when different eBPF programs talking to each other through shared maps and some user space. There are some commands, subcommands of the map command that allows you to actually change the values of the map dynamically, and in some scenarios it can simulate and troubleshoot different scenarios. Sometimes you want to pin a map to a specific program, and then when you execute the program again, you want to reuse the map from a previous run, so you can execute those programs with some maps pre-pinned instead of creating them every time the program spawns. So there's a lot of useful commands, and in general, BPF tool is very useful. I wanted to show you actually, again, you'll find it also in references, but there is a series of tweets and a blog post by Quentin Monnet that covers most of the commands of BPF tool, which is a very powerful tool. In the recent versions, they also have a perf commands that allows you to like profile your eBPF program execution. And BPF tool has a very excessive manual that explains and demonstrates how to use different commands. So, very interesting thing. Sometimes we want to understand, again, we will touch it in the last topic when we'll talk about Cori, but sometimes we need to understand which features are supported by Linux kernel. And there is a lot of different features, like eBPF is emerging and very trending technology, so every time, in every new kernel, there are new features are being added. A useful command, and there are also different filters that we can run that basically prints out the information, what is supported and which helper functions present, and also the config of the kernel. Which features are supported, which features are not supported. Like, for example, let's do. Okay, here we can see that in my Linux here, which is Ubuntu 22, the BTF option, which we'll talk in the next topic, is supported by default. In some older kernels, it was not possible. So this command is useful to understand what can be done, what can be done. Another example here, we can see that bounded loop support is available. When we talked about the verifier and we discussed what is possible and what is impossible, we said that the verifier takes care that you want will not create infinite loops inside your eBPF program. So until recently, I don't remember the exact version, but until Linux kernel 5.something, loops were not allowed at all. But then they added the support for bounded loops, so basically with a constant as a limit, and then they just like unroll the loop into a series of commands. There is also a limitation for each eBPF program. I think nowadays it's 1 million instructions. Okay, we saw a demo. Okay, we'll do it really quick. I want to leave time for questions. Last topic I wanted to talk about is Cori, which is a relatively new, even inside the eBPF domain, way of developing eBPF applications. So just a recap, the traditional BCC approach, writing eBPF code using Linux headers and compiler. We are creating BPF bytecode, which is being loaded and verified and then executed in the kernel. In order to do that, we need to take with us to the target machine the LLVM and CLAG compiler, because we need to compile it on the machine. Why? Because if we compile it on our machine, no one can assure us that it can be executed on the other machine, because there can be different kernel versions and kernel structs can have different layout. Some parameters might be renamed, and that's why we are compiling it on the fly on the target machine using the headers of that machine. The issues with that is that CLANG and LLVM is a pretty fat binary that you can need to take with you to the target machine. You are utilizing a significant amount of resources of the target machine if you need to compile BPF code in runtime. For example, if you're running on some huge Kubernetes cluster with thousands of nodes and then you need to compile it on each one of them, it can result in a lot of unnecessary resources being consumed. And also, no one assures you that kernel headers are presented on the target machine. Sometimes they are stripped. And the last point, which is also significant for the developers of eBPF programs, is you discover even the trivial problems during the runtime when we are, like, for example, compilation program of your eBPF compilation error of your eBPF program will be discovered on the target machine. So the solution that was created to address those problems is called Cori. It's compile once, run everywhere. Basically, it creates it's utilizing a BTF files, which is like special files that contain symbols of Linux kernel, but in a very stripped way. So they're very relatively small, and they allow you to get the crucial pieces of the information of the kernel. Specifically those that are required for your eBPF program, and then your eBPF program can run pre-compiled on any target machine that is supporting BTF. How it's done, there was a few additions in different areas of the entire ecosystem. So the Clang compiler was modified in order to to create a special section for relocations of in the binary, and this section allows the loader of BPF program, which we'll talk in the next bullet, to calculate those program dynamically, understand how the eBPF bytecode should be created. So, for example, if in one kernel some kernel struct contains A, B, and C, and in another kernel there was also included A, B, B1, and C fields, I'm talking about fields, then the loader will be able, using this relocation section, to calculate dynamically and create a proper bytecode. And then there's this libbpf loader, which was created from scratch, which a competitor to BCC tool chain that ties the BTFs, the kernel BTF with the eBPF program and allows the load program dynamically. So in a new way, like if we take this diagram to Cori, then there's eBPF code compiled into the bytecode, and there's a BTF file. My analogy to BTF file is like a PDB files, and then there is a libbpf loader which takes both of them and then creates a relocated and up-to-date BPF bytecode, which then been verified and JIT compiled and run inside the kernel. A few things about libbpf: it's written in C language. It's shipped as part of Linux kernel, but recently there's a separate repo that is being maintained. It allows to build Cori-enabled applications, and I think in the last year and a half, all the BCC tools, or most of the BCC tools, were transformed, and there's also an equivalent version of Cori tools for those BCC tools based on libbpf. There are a couple of wrappers that were created. One is libbpf Go, which is a Go wrapper that using like C Go bindings in order to execute methods of libbpf, and there is another one, libbpfrs. There are a few other wrappers for those languages. BPF tool that I showed you previously is also based on libbpf, and it has specific commands for BTF related operations. Three more mentions of existing open source tools, and I don't have time to show you a demo. So BTF Hub Archive is a repo created by Aqua Security. Basically, it stores BTF files for different kernel versions. So, for example, even if you are trying to execute your eBPF program on some machine that doesn't support BTF or was not compiled with BTF flag, you still can do it by using the BTF files from this repo. They support different distributions, Fedora, CentOS, Ubuntu, and I think a few others. And then you can run your eBPF program on those kernels as well, even if they were not compiled with BTF support. Recent kernels, I think, starting, for example, in Ubuntu, starting from Ubuntu 20, don't remember the exact distribution number, they already compiled with BTF enabled, but previous ones they were not. The problem with it that the BTF hub archive is a pretty big one. If you need to bundle all the BTF files with you and take with like and port it with your application, it's almost 1 gigabyte, which is not very practical. So there was a tool created called BTFGen, guys from Kinvolik. And basically, you don't really need the entire BTF file in order to execute because your eBPF program most probably is using just few structs of Linux kernel. So BTFGen allows you to create minimal portable BTF files. I think just, so like the compressed file that was created from all BTF files for Ubuntu is just weighs a couple of kilobytes instead of almost a gigabyte. Now it was like very recently, I think a few months ago, it was merged inside BPF tool. So basically BPF tool has a gen command and then you can run it with BPF tool. You don't need a separate binary. Last thing is BTF Hub Online is some small SaaS application that we built in secret, basically providing the capabilities of BTF Hub Archive and BTFGen online. So we are basically hosting this application. We have an SDK written in Go and REST API that you can just pull a relevant BTF file. So for example, you need to execute your BPF program on some machine, some Kubernetes cluster, or on some EC2 machine, and then the kernel is not supported, you can just send a live request, get the BTF file, which is a couple of kilobytes, and then you can execute it. The interesting part about BTF Hub Online is that we have some scheduled Lambda functions that are running like every day, and then we provide the forward compatibility. So when there are new kernels are going out, we are calculating, we are creating BTF files for them as well. And that's it. So I think from here, oh, I wanted to mention like there's a, just a second. Okay, there's a awesome eBPF, which is a repo that contains most of the resources grouped by categories about eBPF. There are also tutorials, videos, blog posts, examples, but also tools. I think I mentioned some of them at the very beginning of the presentation, like Cilium and Catran, and also they have here BPF trace and et cetera, et cetera. So it's a nice area to find everything in one place. So I think now we'll get to Q&A. We have just 10 minutes. Yes.
I don't know if it's not, okay. Yeah. I think you mentioned when like tracing a like a Java program. You know, it's much harder to basically like trace when to capture the SSL data just because it's not going to use like a, you know, like an OpenSSL symbol. It's going to use something different. Like, could you maybe go into how you would like capture the SSL sent by a Java program?
Yeah. So what I mentioned is that when we are capturing, when we are trying to put a uprobe on SSL, it's a shared library in our user space, which have a variety of different libraries and different versions. And that creates a little bit complexity for this scenario. Some libraries has exported symbols and written in compiled language, like OpenSSL. In this case, the solution is simpler because you just find the exported method and then you put a hook on it. In some other languages, those libraries are not compiled. They are runtime compiled, like Java, they have a JVM. And the Apache library is being compiled in runtime by a Java virtual machine, so you cannot find a symbol. So in order to hook that, it's more difficult. Like, for example, you can inject some small agent inside the application and find this offset of the function dynamically after it's being compiled into the bytecode, but it's a more complex scenario.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose that even work for purely like interpreted language like Python?
So actually Python does use...
Oh, because it's implemented
in... Yeah. Okay, there's barbecue.